Hello and welcome to a whole new episode of The Week Gone By. I'm Anindo and I will bring you all the news and updates from the last week that made the headlines. Now, on one hand, it was the Japan disaster, and on the other hand, Dalai Lama announced to dissolve his political responsibilities to an elected figure. A massive tsunami triggered by Japan's most powerful earthquake in nearly a century last week brought devastation in northeast coastal Japan, sweeping away houses, ships and cars and set ablaze several buildings, killing over 300 people. Over 500 people were reported missing after the quake, which unleashed 33-foot tidal waves in the country's northwest coast. But however, the toll can go up significantly with the week going by. A wall of water several kilometers wide triggered by the earthquake carried all that it destroyed deep into the mainland. Television images showed fires raging in several building complexes as also major petrochemical complex in Sendai. The tsunami also flooded the Sendai airport. A ship carrying about 100 people was also washed away by the huge tidal waves in Japan's northeast coast, and its fate was not known. Buildings, even in faraway Tokyo, shook vigorously, and there was a wide, muddy stream moving rapidly across a residential area near Natori River in Miyagi, leveling everything in its path. The quake struck at 5:46 GMT and alerts were issued across the Pacific, including areas as far away as South America, United States West Coast, Canada and Alaska. Tokyo Tower, a landmark structure in the capital, also suffered minor damage in the quake. Meanwhile, the Japanese Prime Minister stated that an emergency task force has been activated and also appealed for calm. The government dispatched 8,000 troops to assist in the recovery effort and asked for the United States military assistance. Japan also declared a state of atomic power emergency after the earthquake, but added that no radiation leaks had been detected at or near any nuclear power plants. However, a fire broke out in one of the nuclear facilities, but authorities claimed that they had detected no abnormalities such as radiation leakage. And in another update, Tibet's exiled spiritual leader, the Dalai Lama, last week announced a long-awaited plan to devolve his political responsibilities to an elected figure.
The Dalai Lama has said that he would begin the formal process of stepping down at a meeting of the Tibetan parliament in exile. He said that the move would be to the long-term benefit of Tibetans. The announcement came in a speech by the Dalai Lama marking the anniversary of the 1959 Tibetan uprising. He added that his decision was not made because he wanted to shirk responsibility or felt disheartened, but emphasized that it was in the best interests of the Tibetan people. Meanwhile, Tibet government has requested the Dalai Lama to revoke his decision, citing that the country still needs him.
And time now we head towards Pakistan and check out what's been making headlines during the past week in that country. Now, it was the political side of the Raymond Davis case slowly intensified last week. United States Special Representative Mark Crossman said in a statement that until Davis is not released, business between the two countries cannot resume. Moreover, it was only last week that the Pakistani Prime Minister ruled out any backdoor solution to the case of Raymond Davis, for whom Washington is seeking a diplomatic immunity.
A session court in Lahore on Tuesday adjourned the hearing of Raymond Davis' case till March 16th. The United States national detained for murder of two Pakistani citizens would be charged on the next hearing. Analysts say the court order might not go in favor of Davis in the future. The court, in its previous hearing, had rejected the immunity plea of Davis, who claims he is a diplomat. Meanwhile, it was later in the week that United States Ambassador to Pakistan, Cameron Munter, met with Foreign Secretary Salman Bashir at the Foreign Office in Islamabad. The two discussed the issue of United States National Raymond Davis and the overall standing of the US-Pakistan ties. As per media reports, Munter reiterated the United States' demand to release Davis, whereas Bashir diplomatically said that the issue was in the courts, which would further decide Davis's future. On the other hand, a Pakistani court granted bail to United States citizen Aaron Mark Dehavin, who was arrested by Peshawar police for overstaying his visa. Havin, who hails from Virginia, was arrested in February from a residential area in the northwestern city of Peshawar for overstaying his visa. The official in charge of the case informed that Havin has been ordered to submit a surety bond of 2 million rupees. Havin's release orders will be issued soon after furnishing the surety bonds. Also, Prime Minister Syed Yusuf Raza Gilani stated last week that his sentiments on the issue of Raymond Davis is not different from the nation. He also assured that the government will not act against the interests of the country. It doesn't matter if that differs with the United States on principles. He, however, refused to comment on the issue directly as the case is still on with the court.
And moreover, bowing to strong pressure from the key coalition partner UCP and Maoist, the government of Nepal also indicated that a supplementary budget is on the horizon. Now, both Prime Minister Jhalanath Khanal and Deputy Prime Minister and Finance Minister Bharat Mohan Adhikari have said that the government is going to bring a supplementary budget. Adhikari added that the supplementary budget will address problems such as energy crisis and liquidity crunch in the banking system, among others. Now, meanwhile, the Lankan government has warned that the prices of food items are bound to rise sharply in the near future. The United People's Freedom Party General Secretary and Petroleum Minister Sushil Premajayanta was speaking to the local media there during the past week when he said that prices of food items that are being imported from countries that have been affected by natural disasters would see a sharp increase. Now, meanwhile, Bangladesh Grameen Bank ex-managing director Muhammad Yunus is now seeking for public support to hand over the charges to his successor. Yunus has been fighting for his reinstatement after the central bank sacked him last week on the grounds that his reappointment did not have its approval and that he had been holding the top post illegally since 1999.
Bangladeshi High Court on Tuesday last week has rejected Professor Muhammad Yunus's writ petition. Yunus filed a petition challenging the legality of the central bank order removing him as the managing director of the Grameen Bank. But later in the week, two petitions were filed with the Supreme Court against the High Court verdict that rejected two writ petitions challenging the legality of the Bangladesh Bank's order removing Dr. Muhammad Yunus from the post of Grameen Bank's managing director. Now, calling the sacking of celebrated microfinancer Muhammad Yunus as smacking of political vendetta, Bangladesh media has cautioned that the action may hit the image of the nation globally and affect high-level interaction with the US. Moreover, Bangladesh Nationalist Party's chairperson Khalida Zia said last week that the Nobel laureate Muhammad Yunus has been illegally removed from his post in Grameen Bank. Her comment came immediately after the High Court on Tuesday rejected his petition challenging a March 2nd central bank order that had fired him from the managing director of the Grameen Bank.
Well, time to wrap up this edition of The Week Gone By over here, and I will be back next week again with more news and updates from across South Asia. Till then, goodbye and keep watching TV South Asia.